Hello friends, welcome to CEC Live Lectures. Dear friends, from today onwards, we are starting a very new series, and this series is on entrepreneurship. Dear friends, this is the first lecture in this series, and we are going to give you in-depth knowledge on what entrepreneurship is. We are going to discuss on the meaning of entrepreneurship in detail. Friends, for the discussion on the topic, we have with us in our studios Dr. Namita Rajput. Dr. Namita Rajput is a principal in Sri Aurobindo Evening College, University of Delhi. Dr. Rajput is a prolific professor. She is an author of numerous books. Friends, we know that you always like her lectures, which we upload on YouTube. So friends, as I already said, this is the first lecture in the series, and if you have any question in mind, then do talk to us through our toll-free number. Our number is 1-800-110-430. I repeat, our number is 1-800-110-430. Now, I would like to welcome our guest, Dr. Namita Rajput, once again, and would request her to explain us in detail what entrepreneurship is. Hello, ma'am. Welcome to the lecture.
Good morning, friends. Today we are starting with a new series, as told by Geetika. It's on the entrepreneurship in small business. Entrepreneur is one who undertakes everything and who makes the things happen. Collects everything, every kind of raw material which is required to start a business. He undertakes the most important thing which he does is he undertakes the risk of starting a business. So the role of entrepreneur, the kinds of entrepreneur, what are the steps behind it? How does he start? What important, vital and pertinent steps he takes to make the business going is all about an entrepreneur. So we will be taking each and every angle in this series, and we'll be also talking about how to set up a small business, followed by the introductory sessions on the entrepreneurship. So now we'll be starting with the conceptual framework of what is the meaning of entrepreneur. As you all know, the word entrepreneur is derived from a French verb entreprendre, which means to undertake. So this refers to those who undertake the risk of a new enterprise. An enterprise which is created by an entrepreneur, and the process of creation is called as entrepreneurship. Entrepreneurship is a process of the actions of an entrepreneur who is a person always in search of something new and exploits such idea into a gainful opportunities by accepting the risk and undertaking with the enterprise. So till now it is very clear from the definition and the conceptual framework of the entrepreneurship. That is, anybody who undertakes this kind of an action initiates the risk and undertakes so many activities, and converting the idea into action is done by an entrepreneur. So basically, there are many types of ideas which are present in the world. But yes, he will work upon those ideas which can actually be converted into action. And of course, you know, we'll have definitely a gainful opportunity by accepting the risk and the uncertainty with the enterprise. What he does, he has an array of ideas in front of him. He will, you know, see the pros and cons of each idea and see what are the, you know, the feasible ideas which can easily be converted into, you know, a proper action guidelines. Then, of course, which can reap certain fruits in future, because all the ideas cannot be converted into action. So here, the intelligent role of the entrepreneur is most important. He will undertake the different ideas, you know, compares each and every idea and see the feasible ideas and then convert it into action. And he will also undertake that, you know, pursuing which idea is more gainful, pursuing which idea is more riskful. So there are so many pertinent steps which he will take, which are cannot even measured also. He has a broad spectrum of activities which he does, and to be a successful entrepreneur, he has to undertake these activities very, very diligently. Now, it is basically the propensity of a person to systematize the business of his own and to run in a very, very profitable manner using all the virtues of leadership, decisions making, and with the managerial skills, etc. So this particular line states what? That it is the role of an entrepreneur is not at all easy. The first thing which he does is he has to be very systematic in his approach. He has to be, you know, he has to have a fair idea of what kind of business he is undertaking. He will analyze whether the business which he is undertaking is profitable or not. And he will, you know, embed all his skills together, churn them together so that, you know, he is able to have the best business, the best outcomes of whatever steps he has to undertake. So he needs to have the leadership skills. Leadership skills are most important, because unless and until he shows the leadership qualities, a person can never be an entrepreneur. Then he should have a very good quality of pertinent decision making, which is scientific in nature, which is based on the facts, which is not based on his whims and fancies. And of course, with the managerial skills. What is a managerial skill? Managerial skill is all about getting the work done from the others. If he's able to do that, he's a good entrepreneur. So it is the combination of the various activities, the various skills together, that he will be able to undertake all kind of activities, which is definitely called as an entrepreneur. And the process which he's undertaking is called as entrepreneurship. Now, the word entrepreneurship typically means to carry out. The concept of entrepreneurship originated from the Western societies, and the concept has evolved over time. In the early 16th century, the term was used to signify the army leaders, and way back in the 18th century, it was used to denote the dealer who buys and sells the goods at an uncertain prices. And towards 1961, the Schumpeter used the term innovator for an entrepreneur. So this is a landmark definition which has been given by Schumpeter way back in 1961, and this definition is globally known also. And he has called an entrepreneur as what? As an innovator. Then what does innovator means? We'll come back to this very quickly. Now, basically, two centuries before, the concept of entrepreneurship was very hazy. But if you talk about the recent years, the entrepreneurship has been well recognized across the globe in United States of America, Germany, Japan, and in the developing countries like India. And in India, the definition of an entrepreneur being one who undertakes to originate, own, and to run a business has been accepted in a national seminar on entrepreneurship organized way back in Delhi in 1975. Now, still, there has been a consensus on the definition part of an entrepreneur. So, we'll be talking now on a very important topic called what are the basic elements of entrepreneurship. So, we'll be taking it one by one. The first most important element of entrepreneurship is what? It is economic and dynamic activity. Entrepreneurship is an economic activity, as it entails the creation and operation of an enterprise with a view of creating value or wealth by ensuring the optimum utilization of the scarce resources. These activities are performed on a continuous basis in uncertain business environment, hence it is regarded as a dynamic force. So the most important element part of the entrepreneurship is that it undertakes any kind of an economic activity, that is, which is related with earning and spending of income. Not only this, he will make sure that whatever other resources which are available to start the enterprise should be used optimally. Because there is one thing which have to be kept in mind, that whatever other resources which have to be undertaken to start the business enterprises has to be optimally used, because they are scarce in nature. Nothing is available in abundance. So we have to understand this. Owing to the scarcity of the resources, it is the pertinent and most important and vital role of an entrepreneur to make the things, you know, and deploy the things in a very wise manner, so that the profits are maximum, the cost is the minimum, and there is an optimum utilization of the scarce resources. Now, these activities are performed on a continuous basis and in uncertain business environment. Hence, it is regarded as a dynamic force. Now, see, the entrepreneur has to undertake, you know, various spectrum of activities together. They have to deal with the living and the non-living resources together. So when you talk about the living resources, each one of them have their own likes and dislikes. And it is perhaps The most important element which have to be kept in mind, that to, you know, control the human resources, which are definitely diverse in nature, is the most difficult task. And of course, nonetheless, we are working in the uncertain environment also. You never know when the policies are going to change, when, you know, the most important factor now is about the environment also, when your business can be asked to be shut down because your business is creating a lot of chaos or it is emitting the carbon footprints. So probably the government would not ask you to continue your activities, business activities, and probably you have to stop. So you never know. The future is uncertain. The people are diverse. So owing to these kind of scenario in which the entrepreneur has to work, so it is definitely a very dynamic force. They have to be always on their toes to keep this going on. The second most important element of entrepreneurship process is associated to innovation. Now, you'll be amazed that innovation has to play a very, very significant and pertinent role in the process of the entrepreneurship. How? Let me explain you. Entrepreneurship deeply involves a search of the new ideas on a continuous basis. It forces an individual to evaluate the existing models of the business operations continuously so as to evolve and adopt more efficient and effective systems. Now, let me tell you and explain you the nuance of this. We are living in a very busy world. A contemporary world of today is full of complexities. It is full of new ideas. It is full of research. So, you know, people will, you will be amazed to see the kind of services they start. We are all working, most of us are working. So we have very less time for the families. We have very less time to actually be into a household work. So we look forward for, you know, the delivery services, say the you know, online Paytm services, online existing services. So that is why these kind of services are proliferating and they are mushrooming. And they are successful also. So these entrepreneurship, they always look for certain new ideas, which definitely depends upon the type of life we are leading, the type of people we are. And they see the core of the needs of a particular section of the society and they start a very new service which everyone would like. And if you are successful in reading about the people, understanding their particular needs and then coming on to the innovation part of it, you'll be very, very successful. And of course, for you, the sky is the limit. So this is how the particular entrepreneurship process is very much linked and associated with the process of innovation. Now, according to Schumpeter, entrepreneurship is essentially a very creative and innovative activity. And there are about five ways of being innovative. The introduction of a good new goods, the introduction of a new method of production, operating of a new market, and the conquest of a new source of supply of raw material, the creation of a new organization of an industry. So Schumpeter entrepreneur combines already existing materials and thereby produces something novel and innovative. So it is only at the time when somewhere someone actually puts together such a combination and he is engaged in the entrepreneurship. The entrepreneur tend to tackle certain factors which are unknown. They do things in a very new and different ways. They weave the old ideas into the new patterns. They offer more solutions than exercises. However, just to be an innovative is not enough unless the innovation is carried out into a production to benefit the consumers. So the basic nuance of the entrepreneurship is not only to create something new or maybe old product in new packing or maybe adding to the array of new services or giving more of the important solutions and the questions. So the main role of the entrepreneurship is that the outcome of these services which he will undertake, it should have a very important spillover or the outcome onto the satisfaction level of the consumers. So if you're able to do that, then you're a successful entrepreneur, and the process which you adopt is an entrepreneurship, which is definitely on the path of the growth and development, and the satisfaction level of the consumers would definitely go high. Now coming on to a very important another element of entrepreneurship. This is basically called as a profit potential. See, whatever activities I've said in the beginning also, the entrepreneurial activity, whatever you undertake, has only one perspective, that is economic perspective. So when you talk about the economic perspective, you have to understand each and every activity, and you have to see that from the lens of the profits, that is it potential for future profits or the future returns. So the profit potential is likely level of the returns to the entrepreneur for captivating on the risk of developing an idea into the actual business ventures. So this is all he does. And of course, without any kind of a profit perspective, the efforts and the entrepreneurs would remain only on a non-figurative and merely theoretical activity, which is definitely not enough. Then creative and purposeful activity. The entrepreneurship is creative and purposeful activity. It is a creative answer to the changing environment. Earning profits may not solve the sole objective, but yes, the introduction of something creative and new is the purpose of entrepreneurship. Now, coming on to the advantage of the creative activity, must be enjoyed by the large number of the people. So you have to have one centric approach, that whatever you do, whatever you undertake, the outcome which you will perceive should be profitable to the substantial number of the people, not to very small section of the people. So substantially large number of people, if they benefited from your activity, definitely it is very, very good and important also. So you have to see the overall profit potential of an activity. So let me give a recap of all the things which we have done today. We have started with the conceptual framework of entrepreneurship. So entrepreneurship is one in which you undertake the activities with the profit potential, with the overall perspective of exploiting the ideas into action, and of course whatever resources you have should be gainfully employed, and best potential results should be obtained. Then of course he has to undertake a lot of risk. Then of course the angle of innovator was added by Schumpeter way back in the year 1961, from which the landmark definition changed the conceptual framework of entrepreneurship and added the new paradigms and frontier to it. Then we started with the conceptual framework as far as the elements of entrepreneurship is concerned. The first was economic and dynamic activity. Number one is that whatever we are supposed to do in the future, the overall perspective is economic in nature. That is, we have only one thing, that is either it is related to earning and spending of the income. Not only this, it has to be a very dynamic activities. Why dynamic? Because every day the environment keeps changing, every day the policies keep changing. So you have to work as a dynamic force, you have to be an undertaker who will embed these kind of activities into action. Then of course it is definitely associated with the innovation, wherein the entrepreneur would definitely continuously search with the new ideas, the new habits which are proliferating in the market. And of course you have to be essentially very, very creative and innovative in your approach, because, and of course whatever you do, it has should be a direct spillover onto the benefit of the substantial number of the people. Then we see the profit potential behind it. Whatever you do, you must see that what is the likely rate of return, to the entrepreneur for captivating the risk which you undertake and the idea which you convert into action actually. So without profit perspective, the efforts which you do is multiplied by zero, because you would eventually result into a non-figurative and merely theoretical activity which is not required at all. So creative and purposeful activity is very important, because if you're doing anything without a purpose, it has got no meaning to whatever you do. So you have to have a creative answer for your sole objective of creating a new entrepreneur. Then the next element which we will now talk about of the entrepreneurship is risk bearing. As the name suggests, risk means what? That you have all the willingness to do, but you never know whether that idea will be workable or not. So to some extent, you have to adopt certain risk activities into your business. So if you're a risk averter, the profits would go down. If you're a risk taker, the profits would move up. So the core of entrepreneurship is the willingness to assure the risk arising out of the creation and implementation of the new ideas. New ideas are always tentative. You never know whether they are going to result into a positive side or a negative side. But yes, as an entrepreneur, your primary role is to explore those activities together, and you have to apply your deep sense analysis and other important activities and important characteristics, so that whatever profiling you do of each idea, the tentative results would be positive. So you will definitely only pick up those things which are going to give you a positive results. Otherwise, whatever you do again will be multiplied by zero. So you have to be very patient in analyzing the various ideas which are available to the entrepreneur and see which is good and which is bad. So in the interviewing period, an entrepreneur has to assume the risk. It is the entrepreneur does not have the willingness to assure risk, entrepreneurship would never succeed. So in the interviewing period, the interviewer has to assume the risk that every individual who is undertaking any kind of an activity, it is very, very important to understand, have a clear understanding that whatever we will do, it has some amount of risk behind it. So you cannot avoid that. And if an entrepreneur does not have the willingness to assume that particular risk, you will never succeed as a good entrepreneur. So as a matter of fact, a good entrepreneur will always consider some amount of risk. Only then you would attain the heights, and the sky will be your limit. You cannot limit the risk, you cannot eliminate the risk. It has to be an essential part of whatever activities you do to adopt and to be on the way of the success. Now, coming on to another element of the entrepreneurship. The next is a role of a high accomplishment. Now, the Meckland identified two features of entrepreneurship. One, doing the things in a different and a better way. And B, the decisions making under uncertainty. People having high need for achievement are more likely to succeed as an entrepreneur. The psychological theories assert that the people's capacity for entrepreneurship is decisively influenced by the way they are socialized as children. David Meckland stressed that entrepreneurs are highly motivated by challenging and competitive work situations. Entrepreneurial development today has become very, very significant in view of being a key to the economic development. So the objective of industrial development, the regional growth and employment generation depends upon the entrepreneurial development. The entrepreneurs are thus the seeds of industrial development. The fruits of industrial developments are greater, and of course the opportunities to be unemployed, youth, increase in per capita income, high standard of living, increased individual savings, and of course the revenue to the government in the form of the income tax, sale tax, tax options, export duties, import duties, and of course the balanced regional development. So these were all about the element part of the entrepreneur, and I hope these things are very clear to you. So just a final points which we have done today, because because this is the first lecture of the series, so you must have a strong theoretical base of the new series called Entrepreneurship and Small Business. So we started with the concept of entrepreneur, and as a matter of fact, you must understand what an entrepreneur is. The entrepreneur is one who undertakes the various activities which are associated with the risk of doing a new enterprises. And he does a calculative risk. He has to be innovative in his approach. The entrepreneur is one who carries out, and the process which you carry out is the entrepreneurship process. Then way back in 1961, Schumpeter added a new paradigm, that is being innovative. So you have to be economic. Whatever activities you undertake has to be economic activity. It has to be a dynamic activity, because you have to keep changing your approach as per the dynamic environment which is present in front of us. You have to be very, very closely associated with the innovation part, because unless and until you innovate in your activities, in terms of your services, people will not recognize you, people will not come to you, and you will not be on the road of this success. Then we see the profit potential behind it. And of course, any activity which he undertakes, he has to be very diligent in terms of picking those particular ideas which are definitely converted into action, whose profit potential is the maximum. Then of course, a good entrepreneur will always undertake a risk. It has to be a part and parcel of the culture of the entrepreneur and his work, because unless and until you bear a particular risk activities, you will not be able to have the best profits. Then a role of a high accomplishment is one of the primarily the task of the entrepreneurship. So with these words, I think the things are very clear to you. In the coming session, we'll be talking about the functions of an entrepreneur. Thank you so much.
With this note, thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much for giving us this productive session on entrepreneurship. Dear friends, there is a lot more for you in store. So you are just requested to be with us as we are back after a short break. Thank you. Hello friends, welcome back to the session. Friends, as you know that today we are talking on entrepreneurship in detail. We discussed about the elements of entrepreneurship, and in this session we are going to discuss on function and importance. Friends, for the discussion on the topic, we have with us in our studios Dr. Namita Rajput. Dr. Namita Rajput, a prolific professor, and currently she is principal in Sri Aurobindo Evening College, University of Delhi. Friends, we know that you might have lots of questions in mind, and if you feel so to ask questions, then we are ready to give you answers. Friends, for contacting us, you just need to dial through our toll-free number. Our number is 1-800-110-430. I repeat, our number is 1-800-110-430. Now, I would like to welcome our guest, Dr. Namita Rajput, once again. Hello, ma'am. Welcome back.
So, in the last session, we talked about the meaning, conceptual framework, and the elements of entrepreneur. So, in this part of my lecture, I'll be talking first on the functions, and later on the importance of an entrepreneur. As a matter of fact, every student must understand, because this is the era of being an entrepreneur, a successful entrepreneur. So, unless and until you have the theoretical backdrop in this regard, you will not be able to understand what an entrepreneur is all about, what is the process of entrepreneurship. So, as a matter of fact, we'll be now discussing on the functions of an entrepreneur. So, the important functions which are performed by an entrepreneur are as follows. Number one, innovation. As we, studied in the earlier part, that way back in 1961, there's a person called Schumpeter who added a new paradigm of the concept of innovation. So, innovation is a very important function of an entrepreneur. Let us see how. An entrepreneur is basically an innovator who tries to develop new technology products, markets, etc. Innovation may involve doing new things or doing existing things differently. An entrepreneur uses his creative, the overall facilities to do new things and exploit the opportunities in the market. So what is an innovation means? Innovation is basically trying to add some new technological paradigm, some new markets, some new range of products which are not there earlier, or which they are there earlier with some additional features. So they have only one purpose, that is the commercial purpose behind it. And of course, the innovation may involve doing new things or doing the existing things very, very differently. Because if you see the particular advertisements which are coming around, we always see one thing, that there is a line which is associated and linked in the commercial also, that it is different. So people, they understand that if you're buying something which is new, it gives a lot of solace and satisfaction to your own self as far as your decision making of purchase of product is concerned. So this paradigm has to be very diligently looked upon by an entrepreneur, that whatever he does should be, he should do it very differently, which the others have not done before. Not only this, an entrepreneur uses his overall creative facilities to, achieve this particular objective of doing certain new things or exploit the opportunities in the market of today. What he does, he does not believe in the status quo. He will always search for a change. Now, people who settle for the status quo means what? The status quo is a position of no change. It is a position of equilibrium. So people, if you have a quality of, remaining in the same status as you were before, that means you are not rising at all. And of course, you will always search for the new things or the other. The second is that assumption of risk. An entrepreneur by definition is not a risk taker and not risk shrinker also. So it is always prepared for assuming the losses that may arise on account of new ideas and the products undertaken by him. So whenever you start any activity, the entrepreneur is quite ready that yes, he's undertaking risk. This risk may or may not work for him. Sometimes risk taking leads to additional profits, or the profit becomes potentially viable in terms of profits and returns. But sometimes it can topple the scene also, and you will be, on contrary to earning profits, you will be on the other side seeing the dark side of it. So it has both ways. The risk can give you the profits, the risk can give you the losses also. So it is now on the skill of the entrepreneur that what and at what level of risk he is going to undertake to make the things happen. Now, the willingness to take risk allows an entrepreneur to take initiatives in doing the new things and marching ahead in his efforts. The third important function which we have to do, the first was innovation. The second was assumption of risk, and now we are talking about the third function, which is called as a research. An entrepreneur is a practical dreamer and does a lot of groundwork before he takes a leap steps into his ventures. So that means what? He is not going to take up any activities right away. He has to do a lot of research work that if I adopt path A, this is the scenario. If I adopt B, this is the scenario. And so on and so forth. So if he is satisfied with a particular path, then he will undertake that particular path, and definitely all the leap steps which we will take will be a calculated ones, will be on the basis of his own research analysis. So he has to be very diligent in his working, hard working, and of course which are backed by the empirical evidences also, to support whatever activities he has to undertake. Now, in other words, an entrepreneur finalizes an idea only after considering the various options in mind. One, analyzing their strengths and weaknesses by applying the analytical technique, which is called as SWOT analysis: strength, weakness, opportunities and threat. The strength and opportunities, they are internal, and opportunities and threats, they come from outside. So he has to do a deep analysis, because we are talking about about the business. So business is an open system which is having its own internal system also, and which is having external system also. So as a good entrepreneur, he has to analyze both the internal environment as well as the external environment. And when he adopts these kind of activities and strategies to have the best potential in or the best profits in mind is called as a SWOT analysis. Strength and weaknesses are about what your internal strengths are. About maybe your staff is good, maybe your machinery is good, or maybe you have the wonderful infrastructure in front of you. So they are your strengths. Just an example. And the weaknesses could be the staff is not good, there is a power cut which is going on, the raw material is not available, and so on and so forth. So considering your strengths and weaknesses, we take some opportunity which is coming from the outside environment as an opportunity, and sometimes we take this as a threat which is again coming from the outside environment. So this is what we map these four things together in one frame. And it is the skill of the entrepreneur who is able to analyze these four factors together so that the applicability of converting the thoughts into action becomes more viable, more profitable, more good, less risk, more returns. So he has to be, you know, supplementing them together, and he has to do a lot of research work. The empirical findings, they do a lot of good way in this regard. So all these things together, he is able to choose the best among the alternatives which is available to him. Now, it is then that he applies his ideas into practice. The selection of an idea thus involves the application of a research method by an entrepreneur. Coming on to the fourth function of an entrepreneur, development of the managerial skills. The work of an entrepreneur involves the use of a management skill, which he develops while planning, organizing, staffing, directing, controlling, coordinating the activities of the business. His managerial skills get further strengthened when he engages himself in establishing the equilibrium between the organization and its environment. However, when the size of the business grows considerably, the entrepreneur can employ professional managers for the effective management of the business operations. Now, what next? The next is overcoming the resistance to change. As a human being, we all want to be in the comfort zone. Why comfort zone? Because it gives us a solace, it gives us the peace of mind, because you are already into an existing setup. The moment some innovation comes, the moment some new things come, it disturbs your mind, and it is the human psychology that they resist change, they do not want to change. So the new innovations are generally opposed by the people because it makes them change their existing behavior patterns. An entrepreneur always will first try for a new idea as his own level. It is only after the successful implementation of these ideas that the entrepreneur makes these ideas available to others for their benefit. In this manner, an entrepreneur will pave the way for acceptance of his ideas by others. It is a reflection of his willpower, enthusiasm, energy, which will help in overcoming the society's resistance to change. You know, he has to explain the people, he has to explain the ambit of the people under him that yes, if we implement this change, it is going to be very positive and will have a positive spillover on to the existence of the company, to the happiness of the company, giving more profits to the company, so on and so forth. But yes, he has to be very, very smart, diligent in exposing this kind of a truth onto the people, because it is difficult to change them. It is difficult to have their acceptance levels. So he has to prove it, because people, you know, they believe only certain things if they have certain proofs in front of them. So the good entrepreneur will, it is primarily the main function of the entrepreneur to make people feel that whatever he is saying is truth. So he has to collect all the pertinent material in this regard, prove to the people, show them their enthusiasm, convey their, you know, the overall consequences of adopting that particular new job or the new changes, and he has to overcome eventually the resistance which is related to the society. Now, the next function of an entrepreneur is all about having a catalyst of the economic development. An entrepreneur plays a very vital role in accelerating the pace of the economic development of a country by discovering the new uses of the available resources and maximizing their utilization. To better appreciate the concept of an entrepreneur, it is desirable to distinguish from an entrepreneur and a promoter. The table, basically outlines the distinction between an entrepreneur and the entrepreneurships and the entrepreneurs. And the table 2 portrays the basic points of distinction between an entrepreneur and a promoter. So let me now give you a distinction between an entrepreneur and an intrapreneur. The first, if you see on the left side, it is the owner's capacity. And when you talk about the entrepreneur, it is a manager. A manager is his own boss. When you talk about the intrapreneur, it is the salaried class or the salaried employee. These are the owner's capacity on the basis of which we distinguish between the intrapreneur and the entrepreneur. So I think this is clear to you that when you talk about the entrepreneur, it is about their own self. And in case of the intrapreneur, it is about the salaried people you have hired. The second is your decision making. When you talk about the entrepreneur, you have to take their own decisions. Where else? When you talk about the entrepreneurs, they have to just execute the decisions which are concurrence with the owner. So that means that the entrepreneur has to do what the intrapreneur has to ask them to do, because they are not the owners, they are not the bosses, they are just the salaried people. So their basic function is to adopt the directions as is directed by the entrepreneur. As they are only the salaried employee, as their function is just to execute whatever they have been asked to do it. And finally, when you come on to the rewards, a matter of distinction between the entrepreneur and the entrepreneur is what? When you talk about the entrepreneur, the rewards are definitely unlimited and uncertain. These things you have to be very clear about, that if you see a point of difference between the intrapreneur and the entrepreneur, the basis of distinction, if you take this as a rewards, the first, when you talk about the entrepreneurs, it is unlimited and of course it is uncertain also. Whereas if you talk about the intrapreneur, you're talking about a particular salary which you get, so they are having a fixed rewards and a fixed salary, so they are not bothered in terms of innovating something new, because they are just concerned with their salaries, and by the end of the day and eventually they will get it. But yes, the main role of the entrepreneur is to enhance and increase the profit potential and the overall financial position of the particular business. Now coming on to the differences between the entrepreneur and a promoter, which is also very, very important and pertinent to understand. The first basis which we will take as a point of differences is the stage of business. The entrepreneur is one to bring business into existence. So he undertakes n number of activities together. He collects the raw material, he undertakes so many risk calculated activities, and he makes and starts the enterprise going. So this is the main function of an entrepreneur, to make the business or to bring the business into particular existence. Now, what is the role of a promoter? From conception to continuation is the main function of a promoter. So the promoter has to conceive the idea and gets the continuity in the business is concerned. Now coming on to another basis called owning of the business. The entrepreneur may or may not own it, but yes, the promoter will always owns his specialization. The next nature of difference between these two is the nature of job. So the entrepreneur will include everything, whereas when you talk about the promoter, it is highly specialized. So this was all about the functions of an entrepreneur. So let me give you a recap of what we did in this part. The first important vital activity was innovation. So we have to keep innovating the service, adding new to the existing services, adding new feature to the existing products, adding new markets, exploit the opportunities which are available in the market, convert it into action. The second is assumption of risk. Unless and until an entrepreneur is not able undertaking the risk, he will not be successful entrepreneur. Then he has to do a lot of research activities to make the things going on a right path. And he has to develop a lot of managerial skills because he's dealing with living and non-living staff. Also, he has to direct them, plan activities, staff them, direct them, controlling them, coordinating them. So the next is to overcome the resistance of change, which is definitely, you have to wipe out this from the mind of the people that yes, the change is always for good. So you have to make them understand, you have to kickstart their new ideas so that they are able to overcome the resistance. You have to show the positive side of it, the outcomes of this. So now I'm starting with a new topic called functions of an entrepreneur. It is only after the successful implementation of these ideas that an entrepreneur makes these ideas available to others for their benefit. In this manner, the entrepreneur will pave a long way for the acceptance of ideas by the others. This is a reflection of willpower, enthusiasm, energy, which will help them in overcoming the society's resistance to change. Then we also discussed on the catalyst of the economic development that he has to do a lot of activities so that the resources are used optimally and the profits are good. Then we did the differences between the entrepreneur and entrepreneurs. The entrepreneur is a bigger term, takes their own decision, have the complete ownership, and the returns are unlimited and uncertain. Whereas if you talk about the entrepreneurs, they are salaried people and their main objective of work is to just execute what has been directed to them, followed by they earn only the fixed rewards and the salaries. Then we come on to the functions of an entrepreneurship. The entrepreneur and a promoter is also very different. The main function of an entrepreneur is to start the business, whereas the main function of a promoter is from conception to continuity altogether. So when you talk about the owning business, they may or may not own it, whereas they own the specialization when you talk about a promoter. And finally, the nature of job. The entrepreneur includes everything, whereas when you talk about a promoter, it is highly specialized in nature. Now I'm coming to another topic called importance of entrepreneurship, that how important the process of entrepreneurship is. The first is the development of managerial capabilities. The biggest significance of entrepreneurship lies in the fact that it helps in identifying and developing the managerial capabilities of entrepreneurs. An entrepreneur studies a problem, identifies its alternatives, compares the alternatives in terms of cost and benefit implications, and finally chooses the best alternative. This exercise helps in sharpening the decision-making skills of an entrepreneur. Besides, these managerial capabilities are used by the entrepreneurs in creating the new technologies and the products in place of the older technologies and the products, resulting into higher performance. The second is your creation of organizations. The entrepreneurship results into a creation of organizations when the entrepreneurs assemble and coordinate the physical, human, and the financial resources and direct them towards the achievement of objectives through managerial skills. The third is improving the standards of living. By creating the productive organization, entrepreneurship helps in making a wide variety of goods and services available to the society, which results into a higher standards of living for the people. The possession of a luxury car, computer, mobile phones, rapid growth of shopping malls, etc., are the pointers to the rising standard living of the people, and all this is due to the efforts of an entrepreneur. The next is the means of economic development. Entrepreneurship involves creation and the use of innovative ideas, maximizing of output from given resources, development of managerial skills, and all those factors are very essential for the economic development of the country. So what are the factors, determinants, which are affecting the entrepreneurship? The entrepreneurship is a very complex phenomena included by the interplay of a wide variety of factors. Some of the important factors which are listed below. The first is the personality factors. The personality factors becoming the core competencies of the entrepreneur includes the initiative, that is, it does the things before even asked for. He has to be proactive in his approach, that is, identification and utilization of opportunities. The third is the perseverance, working against all odds to come and remove the obstacles and never complain with the success. The problem solver. It conceives the new ideas and achieves the innovative solutions. Then is the persuasion to workers and the financiers for patronization of his business and develops and maintains the relationships. The next is your self-confidence. It takes and sticks to his decisions. The next is your self-critical analysis. Learning from the mistakes and the experiences of the others is also a very important factor and determinant of it. Then he has to be a planner, that is, collecting the information, prepares the plan and monitors the performance, the risk taker, the basic quality. The next is your environmental factors. These factors relate to the conditions in which an entrepreneur has to work. The entrepreneurial factors such as the political climate, legal system, economic and social conditions, the market situations, etc. They have to contribute significantly towards the growth of the entrepreneurship. For example, the political stability in a country is absolutely essential for smooth economic activity. The frequent potential political protest, bunds, strikes, etc. hinder the economic development and entrepreneurship, unfair trade practices, irrational monetary and the fiscal policies are the roadblocks to the growth of entrepreneurship. Because he has to overcome these challenges once again, that, you know, the trade practices are unfair, the irregularities are there, the monetary and the fiscal policies are not conducive. So he has to, you know, see all these things in one frame, and these are the basic roadblocks which affects the growth of the entrepreneurship. Higher income levels of the people, desire for a new product, sophisticated technology, it needs to be faster means of transport and communication, etc. They are the factors that stimulate the entrepreneurship. Thus, it is a combination of both personal and environmental factors that influence the entrepreneurship and brings about a desired result for the individual, the organization and the society. So now we'll be talking about the dimensions of the entrepreneurship. The first is the intrapreneurship. Intrapreneurship are proactive individuals with a strong desire for action. They are self-starters who do not have to ask to take the initiative. In fact, they are usually doing it. They do not even ask for the permission and may ignore the disapproval and other negative reactions from the environment about their ideas. Secondly, their proactive behavior is focused on the pursuit of an opportunity without regard to the resources they currently control. Somehow, the entrepreneur always seem to find a way to them. And the third, the entrepreneur often pursues something that is some sense is new or innovative. That is the entrepreneurial behavior and the actions, they deviate from the status quo. So it is most important thing that entrepreneur will never go for status quo. He will always look for new opportunities, new innovations, new things which is coming up in the market. So the intrapreneur is employee initiative from below in the organization to undertake something new and innovation which is created by subordinates without being even asked, expected or perhaps not even have the permission by the higher management to do so. I'll be giving you one definition which is given by the Penhock in the Way Bay of 1985 and 1999. Entrepreneurs are the dreamers. Why do those who take the hands-on responsibility for creating the innovation of any kind within an organization, they may be creators or innovators, but are always the dreamers who figure out how to turn an idea into the profitable reality. Then, of course, we are having a new conceptual framework given by the Stevenson and Gerillo. The entrepreneurship refers to a process by which the individuals inside the organization pursue the opportunities independent of the resources they currently control. So overall, we'll be taking this in the next session also, because there's a lot to do as far as the other factors of entrepreneurship is concerned. So I hope with these words, the basic elements, the conceptual framework, the importance, the elements of the entrepreneurship are quite clear to you. So in the coming sessions, we'll be taking various paradigms and the frontiers of entrepreneurship in detail, followed by how to start a small business. Thank you so much.
With this note, thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much for giving us this session on entrepreneurship. And dear friends, we believe that you might have gathered lots and lots of information. Friends, if you feel so that you have certain questions which are required to be answered, then do write to us at info.cec@nic.in, as well as if you wish to give your feedback, kindly contact us through the same ID. We are taking your leave with the promise that we are going to meet again very soon and would be discussing more under the series entrepreneurship. Till then, take care. Goodbye. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you once again.